We'll continue here once again. And at this stage, I want to take a small break because I want to show you some case studies. And I'm going to take you to my desktop, and I have downloaded okay, I will address those questions after a while. So this is one of the case studies that has been given by the author at the site I've talked about, and I will share this with you. He's talked about a 7E avionics system, and I want to just quickly go through the study with you. It has got a good 22 pages. This author of ours, Len Bass, and there's another very important gentleman in the history of object orientation called Parnas. Now, these people, they were involved in a number of aeronautics works, work for the Air Force, the US Air Force, in their early years. And though these case studies belong to the 1970s, the 1980s, the 1990s, very old, these case studies are very important because they have laid the foundation for object-oriented methods. This particular case study built a foundation for information hiding, because Parnas is one of the people who really pushed the idea of information hiding. At this stage, there's another little thing I would like to mention here, that I have tactically tried to maintain a distance between object-oriented analysis and design and software architecture. The reality is, in true life, they mix up a lot. All the artifacts you studied in OAD, I could have conveniently duplicated them in this course because they are all required. But we have maintained the gap so that you do not land up studying the same things twice for two different courses. But the reality is, when you make architectural views, you could use any of the artifacts that you studied under object-oriented analysis and design. Use case text, use case diagrams, interaction diagrams, collaboration diagrams, state diagrams, all of them could be used to make architectural presentations. Now, only thing is, when you make architectural presentations, you work on systems of systems, on modules, on components. You don't work on individual classes. But there could be situations where you could address a single class because that class has an important bearing on certain quality issues. So this is something that we've got to understand very clearly. This little passage is by the authors of one of the references book in object-oriented analysis and design, Gama, Helms, Johnston, Vitsivius. I don't even know, it may be even a textbook. It's these four are famously known as the Gang of Four in software engineering. And they are the people who made design patterns a part of our vocabulary, our design vocabulary. Now, what these people have mentioned here is a very important fact, that looking at the statics and the dynamics of a software system are two independent pictures. Whereas your code structure is frozen at compile time, the code structure gives you no idea at all about how objects communicate. It's something like, you know, we divide the all living things into plants and animals into invertebrates and vertebrates and so on and so forth. You've got a taxonomy of distributing all living things. Now, from the taxonomy, you cannot tell how a digestive system works. How does the respiratory system work? So, with dynamic and static aspects of a software system, these are two independent areas, and they've got to be presented separately. Now, this A7E avionics system they've, in this case study, they have demonstrated use of module decomposition, uses, and process. You all have been looking for examples, case studies. So here's a beautiful case study on how module decomposition, uses, structure, and process. These are all three architectural structures. And with these three structures, the author demonstrates how they presented the architecture for this particular system. Now let's, I am not going to be able to read through 22 pages. I will leave it to you and I will share this case study as a part of today's package. Let's understand. Module decomposition, you divide into modules. Uses, we divide into procedures. And processes, we divide into processes or threads of procedures. What is the relationship between modules? A module is a submodule of another module. Procedures, they require the presence of other procedures. They call each other. And processes, they share CPUs, they can share space. Okay, is the view clear now? Somebody says the view is getting blocked. Dvita, is it clear? Okay, good. So now, modules, they influence which quality attribute? Ease of use. Then uses, ability to fill subsets and develop incrementally. Process, schedulability. Achieving performance goals, because you can have parallel processes. The moment you can divide your project into processes, you can run the processes parallelly. So this is the gains. Now, this is a very famous diagram. You've seen it in your textbook. We have covered it earlier. The influence of an architecture, how the architect influences the architecture, and how the architecture goes back to influence the architect. So you have stakeholders, in this case the naval aviators are the stakeholders. The developing organization is the US Naval Research Laboratory. And this word research is given a lot of importance by author Len Bass. He talks about research laboratory. He says since it's a research laboratory, the interest should be the ability to develop better systems, not so much of having a given system, because if it was a given system for an aeroplane, it should have been done by the Navy, not by the research laboratory. And hence, he feels that this particular project, though it was never used in practice for this particular aircraft, it laid a foundation for a lot of development in future. In fact, all future development on avionics referred back to this system. It became like a mantra, the model, the architectural model for a lot of systems to come in future. Papers presented while this was being developed have become reference points for literature in object-oriented design. And if object orientation has found a future, a lot is owed to this particular job. So, and particularly considering that some of the pundits of the object-oriented fraternity who helped develop it were involved in this project. So technical environment was information hiding, and this is and cooperating sequential processing. These were concepts that were being tried out during that time. And architect's experience was mostly academic, access to other systems. The architect had access to naval experts, aviation experts. But unfortunately, none of these people were people who belonged to avionics or to the Navy. They were academic people, Len Bass and Parnas, these people. Okay. Now, the requirements, this is the aircraft for which it was done. And by the way, this system was not for aviation. It was only for weapon delivery. Now, weapon delivery is a very nice usage, and I'm sure some of you all are army people. where do you deliver the weapons? When you say weapon delivery, you actually mean actually going and damaging the target. The ultimate destination of a weapon is the target which is supposed to bombard or whatever. So this application was for weapon delivery. And it had a number of sensors. Air probe for biometric pressure and airspeed, forward-looking radar in the azimuth and elevation. Elevation is up-down, azimuth is north-south, the angle. Doppler radar is a sound-based radar which can tell the speed. So for ground speed and drift angle is the angle of the way the aircraft's nose points vis-a-vis the direction it's moving. Inertial movement system is the acceleration in the X, Y, and Z coordinates. And from acceleration, if you integrate, most of you must be having a mathematics background, an integration of acceleration will give you velocity, and an integration of velocity will give you space, distance. So if you know the acceleration X, Y, Z, you integrate in each of the directions, you'll get the velocity in each direction at a point of time, and if you integrate velocity, you will get the amount you have moved. So on an aircraft carrier, the inertial movement system can even help you locate an aircraft on board a ship. Then you have 100 different weapons and 6 different underwing bomb racks. So keeping track of having the algorithm for each weapon, because the weight of a weapon differs. So the method of delivery will have to be programmed differently. Then the radar altimeter. This particular system had 3 different ways of determining altitudes. So all the altimeters, and then there were a lot of display devices. A mapping device, a head-up display on the screen itself, transparent display, where you could see in relation to the real world, and alphanumeric display. Okay. Somebody wants to see the solution. We are on page number 4 of 22. The rest of it gives you the solution. So now this is, see, these are the various methods of determining the altitude that are given here. There's a brief note given about the project. Now we come to the decomposition structure. And decomposition structure, we explain information hiding, and specific goals of the module decomposition. And these people did beautiful documentation while doing the project. And then an explanatory note as to how module decomposition achieves quality goals. Ease of change to weapons platform, information hiding. Since you use information hiding, changing the weapon was very easy. The same application could be used for different weapons, because each weapon has its own software and you don't disclose more about that software than was required, only what is required by the overall system. Understand anticipated changes, that was the goal. So formal evaluation processes take advantage of experience of domain experts. So each domain expert provided individual modules. So they worked on each individual module sitting with the domain as thing. Then assigning work teams, by dividing into modules, you could assign the work into work teams. So yes, I will share this case study with you. I will give it to you in the, along with today's lecture material. Then hardware hiding modules. So for each hardware, you wrote a separate module. Behavior hiding modules. So for each behavior, delivery of each type of weapon, you wrote a different module. Software decision modules. Mathematical theorems, physical facts, programs consideration, algorithms, they were all written separately, each divided into a separate module. So application data type module, data bank module. So this is how the modules of filter behavior module, physical modules, software utility module, system generation module, this is how you divide into modules. And here you are, various modules. They listed out all the modules. So this is how you are expected to also divide an application into modules. When you study a system, even before any coding has started, before the designers have got involved, the architect has divided the application into modules while understanding the application. Then we come to user structure. Now the point is that it is the users, the various structures are interdependent on each other. For example, let's go back to a human body case. In the human body, you had respiratory system, digestive system, skeletal system, reproductive system, neural system. It's not as if they don't depend on each other. They use common highways, they have a common appearance. After all, the body parts, the things move to are together, and they send signals to each other also. The neurons send messages to the blood vessels. The skeletal system is controlled, the skeletal system incidentally includes the muscles and the bones and the cartilages and the tendons. So the muscles get messages from the neurons. The circulatory system provides food to them. So it is not as if, you know, these are going to be language from different planets altogether. So when you talk about user relationships, you're talking about procedures. These procedures now will have bearing on the modules. It's not as if now you forget the module system and start off on the procedures. But you start writing procedures, and procedures have an interdependence on calling of each other. So when you talk about user structures, here are the quality goals that were achieved. Goal was incrementally built, designed for platform changes. You may change the platform. Today you are working on Unix. Tomorrow you may work on Windows. And you got to be able to manage the size. Look at the size of application. So by having specialized procedures, you could control the size of the application. So here again, we have lots of procedures. You don't even need to understand it. From an RTX point of view, you need to understand that, yes, they separated the procedures. So when you go to do an architecture, it's not something you're going to do in one day or in a 2 hours examination. And unfortunately, we cannot put you to a 3 years assignment as an architect to evaluate you for this course. So those are limitations of an academic process. But you understand that these are procedures that they wrote for various modules. So there's a mapping between the modules and the procedures also. And within modules, we have multiple procedures for various types of activities. So then we come to the process structure. Look at the processes. Follow the modules, calculate values. There are a number of activities that will carry on parallelly in this avionics system. Demand process, await triggering event, calculate the resulting outcome, output outcome. Call the appropriate device interface procedure to trigger the action in the outside world. So these are various procedures. And here again, map input to output, maintain real-time constraints, provide results of time-consuming calculations immediately. These are the requirements. So you did it through parallelism, through doing certain calculations in the background, by having calculation co-processors maybe. Some things that could be scheduled offline. Now, here's a bit of a dialogue whether we should consider the project a success or not. And then there's a summary. And there's a small diagram here in UML, co-screened data flow view of the system, device interfaces, data bankers, shared services, function drivers, filter behavior, physical models. So this finishes it off. And I will definitely share this with you. What is the difference between a normal module and information hiding module? Well, obviously, anybody who's attending this course would be young compared to our friend Len Bass and etc. When they talk about modules, object-oriented approaches were yet to be developed. So when you have an object-oriented approach, we automatically assume in today's world that modules include information hiding. But if you talk to any of your seniors who have written programs in C, we did not have a concept of information hiding yet. And information hiding has enabled a lot of quality attributes to be brought up. There's no template for doing a case study. There is no template for presenting an architecture. An architect has to decide as to which are the relevant structures that he needs to present. So that's a very important decision of an architect. From an examination point of view, more often than not, the question paper tells you what to do. Let's say a course like this and the examination just launches you in a very small way, but the big picture is much bigger. You have to really get into big things. Now at this stage, I will take a 10 minutes break. Obviously, you can't do a case study like this in the exam because these people took a few years to do it. So at least 6 months to a year is required for this type of a study and then implementing it. These people documented it for posterity, for people like you and me, so that people could study the work they have done. And maybe what you will write today in your professional life might become case studies for the future if your client and your company decides to make it available to the education fraternity, which was done by the US research. By permission, it was published by the author. So I will get back to architectural trade-off analysis method. And I will again, after in the next session, talk about another case study. Yeah, I will give you the URL. I'll give you a copy of the case study also. So now I'm taking a break for 5 to 10 minutes.